Penguin Random House Audio presents Mary B., a novel by Katherine J. Chen. Read for you by Marisa Calin. To Einstein, 2004 to 2017. She certainly took a kind of parental interest in the beings whom she had created, and did not dismiss them from her thoughts when she had finished her last chapter. We have seen, in one of her letters, her personal affection for Darcy and Elizabeth. In this traditionary way, we learned that Kitty Bennet was satisfactorily married to a clergyman near Pemberley, while Mary obtained nothing higher than one of her Uncle Philip's clerks, and was content to be considered a star in the Society of Meryton. From A Memoir of Jane Austen, by James Edward Austen Lee, Chapter 10, Observations on the Novels. I was quiet, but I was not blind. Jane Austen, Mansfield Park. Prologue. A child does not grow up with the knowledge that she is plain or dull, or a complete simpleton, until the accident of some event should reveal these unfortunate truths. My eldest sister, Jane, did not know that she was Hertfordshire's answer to Helen of Troy until well into her adolescence. Walking out with the rest of her siblings in a new pink frock, she attracted the attention of two young men who had been wrestling, and who suddenly stopped to gawp at her, like animals that have for the first time looked skyward and spotted the sun. From a young age, Jane had been elevated by our mother to as high a rank of divinity among the common folk of Hertfordshire as false modesty would permit, while Papa never scrupled to show his preference for Lizzy, his second-born. In appearance, it is true Lizzy never possessed the natural elegance and mildness which blessed her sister. She preferred skipping to walking, dirt paths to paved roads, and the scent of wet earth to any fragrance that could be bottled. But what she lacked in conventional beauty was amply compensated for by an open and spirited temperament which rendered any conversation with her highly energetic and amusing. It was therefore acknowledged, long before my younger sisters and I had any say in the matter, that beauty, goodness, and intelligence had disproportionately concentrated themselves in the two eldest and gone woefully amiss in the three following. Namely, that I had been touched with a plainness in appearance unrivaled throughout the whole country, and Kitty and Lydia with a willful propensity to ignorance that exposed them continuously to ridicule without their ever becoming aware of the fact. I will tell you the story of how I knew myself to be plain, and therefore devoid of the one virtue which it behooves every woman to have above all else, if she possibly can. A plain woman, unless she is titled and independently wealthy, will always find herself in a position of extreme disadvantage to her more attractive peers, and the deficiency will haunt her until she reaches an age by which the condition of being withered and crippled will excuse her from her plainness. I can attest to the numerous petty prejudices she will suffer at the hands of individuals she has never wronged or even met before, like the butcher, who, for the same money, would choose to save a better cut of meat for a more attractive patron, or the surly housemaid, who'd accept abuse from a beautiful mistress while resenting the same treatment from a plain one. I discovered my plainness before I was fully a decade on this earth. The incident occurred in a small wilderness that formerly bordered my family's modest estate and which concealed all sight of the house once you'd fully entered it. Someone, probably Lizzy, proposed a game of chase, and it wasn't long before the wilderness shook with the peals of our laughter. Out of all of us, Lizzy was by far the best runner, for she had long arms and legs that reached uncannily far, and she could leap through a space no more than 2 feet wide without tearing any part of her dress. When she ran, her black boots clipped the earth as sharply as the cloven hooves of deer that spring from birth with unstudied elegance. After the first few minutes of frenzied running, I began to tire of the noise and of the pain in my chest from being unable to catch my breath. Even as a child, I did not often avail myself of opportunities to study my reflection in the mirror. But I can well imagine what a sight I looked, stumbling from tree to tree with my mouth hanging open, trailed by an orb of gnats that formed a sort of mock halo around my head. My tongue tasted dry and bitter, like old leather that had begun to flake. I thought of calling Mrs. Hill to fetch me a glass of water, but Mrs. Hill wouldn't have heard me, not even if she were at that moment hanging the washing out to dry or beating the bedsheets with her stick. Those who have tended to children or remember being young themselves will know the far range of a child's imagination. A mother or governess may leave a room for only a few moments before a child will believe he has been forsaken by all who love him. In silence, he may think he hears ghoulish cries. In innocent furnishings, frightening apparitions transpire to haunt him. At the bottom of a tall shrub, I quietly considered my fate. Should I fail to find my way back to the house, I was sure I would transform into a raving feral child. I envisioned myself kneeling at the mouth of a stream, lapping water like a dog. Soon I would know every tree and bush in this wood by their name and speak fluently the language of the swallow, the house martin, and the nightingale. I would sleep on a bed of moss and dress my wild, unkempt hair with the wings of butterflies and their midnight brethren. I would make rings of beetle shells and swallow eggs whole. Over time, my nails would turn as black as the earth from foraging. I'd mash elderberries with my hands and drink their pulp and sustain myself on turnips, mushrooms, and spider legs, all of which I'd consume on a slab of stone. Then, one morning, I'd discover that I'd forgotten my own name and the names of my sisters and my parents. While brooding on these thoughts, I suddenly heard the papery rustle of leaves and spotted a slight figure advancing towards me at an alarming pace. The white dress identified this person as Lizzy. I sat up and straightened, but didn't make any attempt to stand, much less run away. As the distance closed between us, I watched her face weave in and out of shadows cast by overhanging foliage. Drops of scattered sunlight glistened across her forehead, illuminating her eyes. I waited for her to look away, or to laugh, or to appear a little embarrassed at finding me. But her gaze was as concentrated and impassioned as that of the goddess Diana in the ecstasy of the hunt. With a single airy leap over a clump of dead leaves, Lizzy landed in front of me and placed a warm hand on the top of my head. Smiling now and seemingly restored to the cheerful disposition I'd always known, she said, "I've got you, Mary. You've lost." If the game had ended then, that afternoon would have little to distinguish it in my memory, beyond Kitty crying at the discovery of a torn sleeve. But when Lizzy helped me to my feet and we rejoined the others, we found that a sport of a different nature had begun in our absence. After cornering Jane in a small hollow, our youngest sisters had commenced to celebrate their hard-won victory by throwing fistfuls of earth at her dress. As it had rained only that morning, the soil was wet and easy to shape, and they stamped and shouted and baited poor Jane like two rosy-cheeked devils performing a ritualistic dance. Lydia, in particular, enjoyed the activity so much that all speech she uttered seemed an indecipherable jumble of giggles and screams. In Lydia's defense, whatever scandals may now be associated with her name, She never possessed a deliberately malicious character. But years of indulgence from Mama and Aunt Phillips, who both happened to find the senseless amiability with which Lydia approached all matters in life endearing, had emboldened her to say and to do whatever happened to take her fancy, with little concern for others' feelings and no thought to the consequences of her actions. Kitty, the elder.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.